inspiring, educating, and offering hope for families like yours. This is the Dr. Sonia Sutherland Show. A licensed counselor for 18 years and now a professional of counseling, Dr. Sonia wants you to know that you can be happier, your family can be stronger, your marriage can be peaceful and loving, that safe, open, and enjoyable relationships with your sons and daughters is possible, and that you and your children can have the emotional strength you need to lead a life with few regrets. The phone lines are open, so reach out to Dr. Sonia right now at 678-688-IBNX. That's 678-688-4269. Or send your questions to www.helpformyfamily.com. And now, here's Dr. Sonia.
Hello, everyone. This is Dr. Sonia, and once again, I'm glad that you're joining me. Today, we are talking about the complexities of PTSD in our veterans, and we're talking about how this not only impacts them, but impacts their families. Unfortunately, often when we hear the term PTSD and veterans in the same sentence, what most easily comes to mind are mass shooting events that we see on the news, right? And we know that those events are filled with grief for victims and their families, and they're filled with grief as well for the loved ones of the soldiers who often are struggling so significantly, right, with untreated mental illness and undiagnosed PTSD, and such that the only options that they see are filled with violence or suicide. And that's what most people commonly talk about, but what they don't talk about enough are the struggles of the large majority of our veterans, right, and the complexities of their day-to-day realities of life post-war, adjusting to reintegrating in society and reintegrating with their families for months, years, even decades after they have retired, and the struggle that exists there. And so we'll be talking about that today, and I kind of think that this is really important for us to consider, because there's more that's at stake than just talking about the mental health of those soldiers. What's at stake is also those families, because now they're back home with their wives and their children, and their ability to manage through all of those issues that come up with having been a soldier and seen all that they have seen and had to do all that they have done, it impacts how they can connect or not connect with their wives and their children. And so now you potentially have an intergenerational impact going if soldiers are not able to really find the help that they need and understand what's going on for them. And if people don't understand what's going on for them, if their wives don't understand what's going on for them. And so that's why I just think it's important for us to really talk about this. We say on our show that we are all about family, and we say that we want to give them the tools that they need to be successful, to be strong. And I don't want to leave out veterans as well. So with us on the show today is J.J. Widener. And J.J. is an associate marriage and family therapist and an associate professional counselor and a certified drug and alcohol addictions counselor. And there's a couple more. I know this gentleman has alphabet soup up the wazoo, right? Tell us the other ones.
I'm a board certified telemental health provider. And I can't really.
And some other stuff.
I can't remember.
And some other stuff. Well, tell us just a little bit about, in the work that you've done with veterans, what does trauma look like for them? What does combat related trauma, knowing that when we talk about PTSD in the typical sense, this is PTSD kind of on steroids. Right? Tell us more about that and what you see in your clients.
You know, typically, there's a lot of anger. Mm-hmm. There's a higher rate of substance abuse, alcoholism among veterans. You know, you see a higher rate of sort of marital discord, mm-hmm. I guess, emotional disconnection. When reactions happen, it tends not to be a sort of subdued reaction. Yeah. There's a greater propensity that it's going to be externalized in some way. Mm-hmm. Nightmares, flashbacks mm-hmm. from any number of stimuli, whether it's fireworks, cars backfiring, mm-hmm. you know, those mm-hmm. sorts of things. Mm-hmm.
And so when we're talking about that, and as we paint that picture, right, to understand that experience, because the words are the words, the experience is a little bit different thing, right? And so we think about the idea of coming back and experiencing those symptoms that you're talking about, it's almost like a soldier comes back and all of those memories, all of those visual things that they have seen during war, all of the horrible things that we know when we look at movies and we see right. it, they like are right there and they've mm-hmm. lived it and it's been in front of them, 10 feet in front of them. And then they have all of that that they've got to manage through in their head and make sense of. Because remember, when I think about the idea of making sense of that, I think about the fact that most of our soldiers don't grow up seeing that stuff. That's just stuff from the movies. And the idea that that could be a reality that I would be right in, that would be right in front of me and that I would see and be involved in and be a part of, it's not that glorified soldier thing. It is the horrors, right? And so when I think about that, it's like a disconnect, isn't it? From somebody in their mind, does that really happen? Yes, it does. It's not in the movies. It actually does happen, right? And so then you come back, and I think about, a friend of mine shared a video with me, and it was a video of a soldier going through his daily life, and as they did the little things, pack the knapsack, put my notebook in, going wherever, put my coffee, whatever, he's doing those things, and it's flashing back to the war.
Right. When
to prepare for the day,
right.
he cleaned his gun, checked to see if he had enough ammunition so he wouldn't run out, checked to see where all the other things. So he's flashing back, doing these normal things, and flashing back to what was happening for him in the war, and it's like they meld.
Right.
And they somehow, he's driving down the street, and like you were saying, a car backfires, and all of a sudden, it's an explosion.
Right.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. And so when we think about their experience, right, mm-hmm. it's understanding that there's almost like two worlds melded together that they can't seem to flesh apart
mm-hmm. right.
and make mm-hmm. sense of. Does that sound right, JJ?
Yeah, it's polar opposite environments. Mm-hmm. You know, it's most of these men and women, when they go through training, they're being trained to perform in a combat environment, mm-hmm. you know. They're being trained to shut off emotion, to run towards gunfire rather than away from it. You know, they're being trained, in essence, to kill. And that's what, you know, as a nation, that's what we want. The problem is that you can't just turn that off.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm. So you get back home, and it's a, you know, fairly stable, just certainly a safer environment. And, you know, you may come to terms with that in your head, know you're back home, but trauma's effects on the body and your nervous system and things like that, mm-hmm. your nervous system is still operating at a really hyper-aroused state. Mm-hmm. So
right.
it's not just a matter of just, you know, calm down.
Yeah,
you know, just calm down.
Cognitively knowing, right.
Right.
Right, right. And so then it makes us think a little bit of being in a work situation or being at home or being in any situation. And I imagine myself in the mind of a soldier, and the not just the already existing trauma, heightened arousal state, all of that happening, but knowing that you can't control the stuff that's going on right now and how much anxiety that then adds on to what you're experiencing, because they may not even know, like, what is going on
right.
with me. Yeah.
Right. There's, you know, whether it's the anxiety that, and I think a lot of times, a lot of the vets and active duty that I've worked with, they really do a very good job of managing a lot of those symptoms, you know. But it's hard. That anxiety, that anger, the potential things that they deal with, you know, the alcoholism, whatever else can come along. You know, after a while, those things turn into a depression. Those mm-hmm. things turn into a, you know, what's wrong with me that I can't deal with this? What's wrong with me that I'm that I am so angry or that I can't sleep or that the slightest thing sets me off, you know, and that runs into sort of the challenges finding treatment that we can talk about later, that it turns into a hopeless situation. Mm-hmm. You know, how do I deal with this? Mm-hmm. Why am I? And that's kind of the body-mind piece. You mm-hmm. know, that's your body continues to react to this. Right. And when your mind is trying to tell you you're in a safe place.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so we talked about some of the re-experiencing, right, as a symptom of trauma, and the reliving of those experiences. Even the severest ones, seeing dead bodies. I know of a story that someone told, and that person's responsibility as part of his team, it was kind of like cleanup. Mm-hmm. And so everything wow. happened, and then he would be part of the crew that went in to try to retrieve the bodies of his wow. teammates. To make sure that they could get shipped home.
Wow.
Right, so imagine.
It's a lot of pressure. That's a lot to have to deal with yeah. and bring back.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. Especially yeah. when the individuals you're bringing home are people that you train with, people that you develop a strong relationship with. You know, it's difficult to even see our loved ones, you know, pass. That aren't in the military,
mm-hmm.
but to go through that in a military state, the trauma is devastating
mm-hmm.
because of the camaraderie that you develop. Mm-hmm. In fact, being prior service, I know that I have had stronger relationships with people in the military than I've had with family members.
Mm-hmm.
So the devastation of having to deal with seeing that person that you just spoke with 10, 15 minutes ago is no longer going to be there for you to speak to.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so that's difficult. That's very difficult.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And not only not there for you to speak with, but you see the potential carnage.
Mm-hmm. Right.
What happened to them.
Yeah.
Right.
Right.
Right. And then I imagine questions. Why him?
Mm-hmm.
Why her, not why not me?
Right.
Or guilt.
Mm-hmm.
And rage.
Mm-hmm.
And rage.
And I think what a lot of people don't understand is you see those things and it's like we're going back to work.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes right after that,
mm-hmm.
you know,
right.
or the next day. There's
right.
no time off to come to terms with that.
Yeah.
We're
right.
we're moving into the next situation where that's likely going to happen again,
mm-hmm.
and, again
right.
and again and again
and
again.
And like you said though, JJ, it's taking their emotional state and really numbing it and putting it on hold, really. Because, like you said, this happens, he goes in, he cleans up, and then guess what? The next day, maybe even later that evening, it's the same thing all over again, you know?
Yeah.
And they have to. I mean, I can only imagine being out there, seeing all of this, and being emotional about it.
Mm-hmm.
Then that puts the rest of my team at risk.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Absolutely. And most of the combat PTSD is delayed onset, meaning that it's just more than 6 months between
mm-hmm.
when it happens and when symptoms show up. But in almost every case, it's after someone returns home.
Right.
You know, as long as service members are in that environment and those things are happening and they don't experience those symptoms.
Right.
You know, the emotions are there, the sadness certainly, but it's after people come home that everything, when there's no other, you know, we're
yeah.
not expecting
mm-hmm.
a firefight or something later. It's just
right.
everything
right.
calms down and then the symptoms just flood in.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
because now they have time to reflect.
Mm-hmm.
Now they have time to actually go back and start feeling those emotions when they're in a combat situation. They have no time for that.
Right.
It's a constant, let's go, let's go, let's go.
Mm-hmm.
We have to keep moving. We have to keep going forward. We have to keep pressing
yeah.
versus being home and there's just dead stillness, silence.
Right.
And now you have to come to grips with what you've experienced and gone through and witnessed.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then that makes me think of, you know, you have your vet who's home and the already heightened arousal state that they're in, the re-experiencing, and in the middle of dealing with all of that, as it hits them, Daddy, I need this. Mm-hmm. Honey, mm-hmm. please do this. Mm-hmm. Boss, mm-hmm. I need you to do this.
Right.
And then I picture soldiers who, with all that additional stimuli hitting them, mm-hmm. who want to just pull back and completely just kind of lock away and right. separate.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right? Because right. I can't deal with all of that.
Right. Right.
I'm trying to figure out what the heck is happening
right
here.
Right.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think in any family system, when you have one member that's away for an extended period of time and then they come home, the family's found a way to operate without that person. So even, you know, mm-hmm. even if it's not a service member, whether it's a truck driver, whatever, when you come home, there's an adjustment period. Nobody knows how you're going to fit back in mm-hmm. there. What mm-hmm. what is my role? What do I resume doing? What are the responsibilities? But then on top of that, what I'm seeing is a lot of vets have an issue being emotionally available to mm-hmm. for their children, for their wife. How do mm-hmm. I be emotionally present when mm-hmm. these things are still going on? You know, they're still going on inside me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's hard for the wives. I was married to someone in the service, and I remember that transition coming home. It was such an adjustment for everybody involved, mm-hmm. you know, and then they want to help, but they don't know how to help, like mm-hmm. you were saying. And then the wife is so used to managing everything to say, okay, well, let me release this. But then in the back of their minds, they're like, I don't know when you're going to be sent back out.
Mm-hmm.
So why am I going to release this to you? And I think that's where you get a lot of the marital discord, you know, because it's mm-hmm. it's control, mm-hmm. it's power at mm-hmm. that point. And now you're fighting this. And I don't think we at home truly understand what's going on back
yeah.
there.
Yeah.
You know?
Right.
Yeah. There's definitely not enough space, safe space,
mm-hmm.
education for families to be able to really truly grasp
right.
what is coming back,
right?
What's coming back to me potentially, yeah. right? And so you have the soldier who's facing the reality of people telling them, you're different. You're not the person mm-hmm. that left. Who are you?
Yeah.
While they're also trying to figure out, okay, mm-hmm. who am I?
Right.
Right? Mm-hmm. How do you deal with that? Right? How do you deal with that? And then, and we're going to go to break in a couple of minutes, but the other piece of that is, once, assuming that a vet does, in fact, go and seek help, because there are a lot who don't,
mm-hmm.
right? Assuming that they do, right? Most often what we find is there is comorbidity happening. Mm-hmm. It's not just a diagnosis of PTSD, right? Or traumatic brain injury, right? Then there's also substance abuse, there's depression, there's mm-hmm. other things that are coming up
right.
and that need to be treated as well. And so it's a larger struggle than just the trauma itself.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Bad dreams, another symptom of PTSD that they have to manage. So it almost seems like they're dreaming at night and they're dreaming in the daytime. And it's where's it's the relief? And of mm-hmm. course, there'll be, the severity will change, will differ from person to person, right? But then how do you create a situation where a vet feels safe enough to get help, mm-hmm. especially coming out of the military where right. everything, that culture is just very different. It's extremely different.
Mm-hmm.
And you handle your business. Right, there's no such thing as I'm too emotional, I can't handle this or I can't handle that.
Right.
You're holding it together, and you better hold it together. Right, counseling is not the thing in the military, not the way it is out here.
Right.
Right.
All right. So we'll talk more about that when we come back, and we'll talk a little bit about trauma in particular and how it affects the body when we come back to the Dr. Sonia Sutherland Show.
Family Foundation is a national nonprofit dedicated to donating shoes, socks, and emergency clothing to students grades K through 12. BFF was started in honor of a young man named Kalen, who was tragically taken from his family at the age of 17 due to a car accident. His memory lives on through the foundation. We are seeking corporate and community partnerships to fund and support for other families in crisis. If you or your community relations team are ready to partner with us and help inspire others, please contact Tony at weblendwewin@gmail.com.
Peace in your family relationships instead of conflict? Do you want a safe, loving marriage instead of one that is failing? Are you troubled about what's happening with your children and need help for them? At Legacy Changers Counseling Centers, the goal is to strengthen individuals and families with cutting-edge emotional and mental health interventions. The exceptionally trained counselors at Legacy provide the specialized guidance you need in a safe environment of belonging so that you can make the life changes you and your loved ones need. Get real help for your emotional and relationship needs. Call today at 404-334-7575. That's 404-334-7575. You can also find us on the web at LegacyChangersCounseling.com. Call now and transform your life today. 404-334-7575 or LegacyChangersCounseling.com.
Yeah.
You're listening to IBNX Radio, the home of the Dr. Sonia Sutherland Show, right here every Monday from 10 a.m. to noon.
Everybody, welcome back to the Dr. Sonia Sutherland Show. We're talking today about PTSD and veterans and the trauma they experience and how that shows up when they transition into civilian life. Monique, you had a question that came up during the break. You want to throw that out there?
I did. I was wondering if there is some kind of transitional experience, if you will, that the service members have or being offered from the military when they come back in from being overseas or wherever they are, whether it's 6 to 8 weeks, and they do just therapy here stateside before they transition over into their families. Because I feel like there is, as you were saying, JJ, earlier, there's this missed opportunity, I guess, if you will, where the service member is getting the help they need before they get home. Mm-hmm. And as we were saying, you know, once they're here stateside, that's when everything starts to flood because they're no longer in that combat day to day, you know, and just being heightened. So do you know of anything that is being offered to our...
You know, if it is, I don't know about it. None of the vets or anyone has mentioned it to me. Okay. I think there's sort of this unintended consequence at play there, because I think the military sort of looks at it as, if you need help, ask for it and we have resources. Mm-hmm. But you know, you see the same problem in first responders today, is that if you tell someone you're having a problem, then odds are, well, there's a chance you may not be going back out with your unit. And you know, these guys, they have their battle buddies, and they're not going to miss that. Mm-hmm. So there's, when you're asking for help, you have to be cognizant of that fact. Mm-hmm. And most guys aren't going to do that. It's more important for most soldiers to be there for their buddies than it is to seek help for their own issues, you know. Okay. And there's even, you know, I've had vets tell me that after combat experiences, you know, they would be basically coached on how to answer questions. And as I said, if you want to stay out here, these are the answers you're going to want to give to these questions, because if you answer in another way, you may not be here. You may be going back to wherever for therapy or treatment, something like that. So, you know, these guys want to be out there. They want to be out there in what's going on. That's what they signed up for. So they just don't ask for much help, typically.
So the responsible thing to do, our government should really be offering this, right? Because if they're coming back, and there's so many veterans that are on the streets, who are homeless, one, who have such bad substance abuse because they're trying to numb everything. If this was our children, you know, sitting in school and we're seeing certain behaviors, we're very much aware that, hey, they need help. Johnny needs help. Susie needs help. But the veteran that we have trained to be a soldier, they too need help, you know? So I don't want to take this on an advocacy route, but I just really feel like our government should be really doing something for the veteran before they come home, because if not, what we're going to see is what happened with the Vietnam War. When they came back here, there was nothing for them. And they, a lot of them, you know, unfortunately, were addicted. And in their 40s, 50s, 60s, they stayed addicted and didn't get any help.
Right. And, you know, and I think that the government's attempt through the VA to provide those services is there, but I think it sounds like it may clash with the culture of silence that is perpetuated while they're in service, and that may clash with just our own culture, where there's still, just in general, is a great deal of stigma around mental health issues. Mm-hmm. You know, military notwithstanding, in the civilian world, there's still stigma around mental health, right? And then if you look at it along cultural lines, you know, that also plays into whether or not folks may be willing to say, I need some help, and I'm going to actually ask for it and get it, mm-hmm. right? And so there are things that contribute to that. And, you know, the VA is not perfect, but the VA is there right. offering some level of assistance. Could it be more or better? Reporting says yes. Mm-hmm. I mean, folks that talk to me say it could be better. I don't know personally because I've not been involved with the VA and I haven't done a lot of research on it. But just anecdotally, folks say the VA services could be better and access could be better.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. The problem that I've seen is that the government is reactive versus proactive. Mm-hmm. You know, instead of taking the responsibility of saying, okay, we're going to give you this help. We know that you need this help. They're on the other side of saying, if you need this help, come to us, instead of saying, no, we're going to take care of you regardless of right. what you feel mm-hmm. because we know that there's issues that you have to deal with. Mm-hmm. So that's the issue, is that they're reactive and not proactive. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and there's, you know, there's one good thing about the anger and the substance abuse and the marital problems, and it's that's what brings people to therapy. Mm. You know, that's one commonality between combat PTSD and basically any other kinds of trauma therapy. Very few people come in saying, hey, I have some trauma I want to work on.
Mm-hmm. Right, right.
Most exactly. of the time it's a marriage falling apart or alcoholism or something like right. that, you know, mm-hmm. And if you're not careful and you don't do a trauma-informed assessment, you miss that, you mm-hmm. know. But mm-hmm. you look at it and you go, I've had couples come in. We just can't get along. Well, this isn't really a couples problem. This is a PTSD problem. Mm-hmm. You know, right. this is we need right. to work on that first. Mm-hmm. The problem's not alcoholism. The problem's PTSD. You know, if you right. focus on the alcohol use, you're focusing on the symptom.
Right, yeah. mm-hmm. right, so, right, exactly.
But there's also a disconnect somewhere. I don't know where it is between the services that are offered and what vets are receiving. You mm-hmm. know, and I have no idea how the VA works. I'm certainly this is not an attack on them by any means. But you know, I get guys in all the time that aren't even aware of what's out there. Mm-hmm. You know. They saw a psychiatrist one time and got some Prozac. And, mm-hmm. But from a therapy standpoint, they really haven't been told anything, you know. And then mm-hmm. I get vets in who have been to someone that accepts TRICARE, so, you know. But just because someone accepts TRICARE doesn't mean they're good at trauma therapy. So
right.
they come back with worksheets or all they're doing is these cognitive behavioral coping skills, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. I've had vets tell me that their therapist had told them, you know, if you don't like crowds, go stand in Walmart for an hour or something. Yeah. There's some new things that are out that are very good trauma therapies that can get to a lot of these problems. But like I said, there's just some kind of disconnect there. I don't know where it is or how to overcome that or what, but it's definitely there.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Well, let's talk a little bit then just about trauma in the body and how it's experienced in the body. Tell us a little bit about what you've seen as you have worked with veterans in terms of how that has shown up for them.
Right. Well, you know, I think it's important to just sort of to talk just for a second about how PTSD is formed, you know. And I use the analogy a lot of times, you know, if you're walking down the street and you look behind you and there's this huge dog and he's chasing you and you're parasympathetic nervous system kicks in, or your sympathetic nervous system kicks in, and your blood flows to your muscles, and you take off running, and then you look behind later, and he's gone, and then the opposite portion of your autonomic nervous system kicks in, it brings it back down. Well, what happens in PTSD is that reaction does not occur. Mm-hmm. The response that brings things back down does not occur. So you're continuously living as if that giant dog is chasing you, even when you're at home, when you're asleep, everywhere you are. So your nervous system's existing in this state, and you can imagine the anxiety, the anger, the abrupt externalized reactions that can occur from something like that. But you know, you see flashbacks, you see difficulty staying on top, paying attention, you know. Mm-hmm. You see difficulties, you see nightmares happening all the time mm-hmm. that you can't shut off, you mm-hmm. know? And, mm-hmm. You know, just yesterday I saw this, just happened to come across this picture of I guess it was around July 4th, and a vet had a sign in his yard that said, you know, vet lives here, please be conscious of fireworks. And I think people see that sign and they think that just, you know, fireworks must make him nervous, or it just must be hard for him to remember those sounds. And that's not really all it is. You know, there's two important things that happen in a flashback. You lose track of where you are and mm-hmm. when you are.
Right.
So when a flashback occurs, it is not now and you are not here. Mm-hmm. You're there right. and it's then.
Right.
You know, it's a complete dissociative experience. So it's not just that those fireworks make me nervous. It's that they cause me to believe that I am back in Afghanistan or right. back in Iraq, and these things are happening real time.
Right.
Right.
You know, and then the potential then for those things to, for there to be a negative reaction in the home mm-hmm. somewhere just increases exponentially. Mm-hmm. You know, any number of reactions can occur because it's not now.
Yeah.
It's not, you're not here, right. you know?
Right, wow. right. And you talk about how your system changes, right? And you're constantly in a state of hyper-arousal because you think there's that dog behind you chasing you, right? And that constant state of hyper-arousal then does more in terms of shifting the chemical balances in your body and leads to some changes in how your brain actually responds, right? Mm-hmm. To normal stimuli in the world, right? Mm-hmm. And so, go ahead and talk about that.
Yeah, absolutely. There, you know, there's kind of a push now to drop the D from PTSD. And there's a lot of clinicians that are saying that's stigmatizing. It's not a disorder. It's just a maladaptive wiring of your brain that's based on traumatic experience. And we can change that. There's terrific therapies out there today that we can really work with that and change that and help that nervous system calm down a little bit, you know. Mm-hmm. But it's just hard. You have to approach those things in the right way. You know, you never want to look at a vet and say, calm down. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's not the thing to do,
right,
you know. There's typically going to be a negative response after that, you know.
Right.
If they could just calm down, they'd have done it by now. Uh-huh. And they don't need people just spitting that at them, you know.
As if they didn't want to calm down.
Right, or right. as if yeah. they just hadn't considered that option, mm-hmm. you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I think that speaks to understanding how it is not necessarily a choice that veterans are making when certain types of reactions are occurring for them,
mm-hmm.
right? Sometimes these things have become hardwired reactions born out of the trauma of war, mm-hmm. right? And so they become automatic, built-in reactions that then, it's almost like when we think about how habits are born, mm-hmm. right? And how in the brain there are neural pathways that drive certain types of behaviors because they've been repeated and repeated and repeated and repeated. It's kind of, and so we think about the idea that for someone then to shift that behavior, shift that response, it's like kind of paving over a road and creating a whole new road. That's what happens in your brain, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. And so think about how long it takes, even just from how long it takes to pave over a road and create a road. We know from Atlanta traffic, it takes years to create a road, right? And so certainly we're not talking about Atlanta traffic, but the analogy is the same. The premise is the same.
Mm-hmm.
In order for change in behavior and change in understanding, we're looking at changing the brain
mm-hmm.
and how, so it's not as simple as calm down.
Right.
Yeah.
And it's funny that you say about paving a road. You know, we can pave a road. What the time it takes for us to pave that initial road is actually shorter than it takes for you to repair that road.
Mm-hmm.
So wow. you have to realize mm-hmm. when you look at that analogy of repaving a road, they're starting here. And they're experiencing all this trauma and everything that's going on
mm-hmm.
up to this point to where now it's time to repair it.
Yeah.
That repair is going to take even longer and harder
yeah.
because you have to actually break up that road,
mm-hmm.
pull it apart, segment it, reconstitute all of the materials that you have,
yeah.
and try to put it back together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. in a way that makes it function well.
Right.
For where you are right now. Right.
Yeah, and a lot of times it's just easier to live with a bad rote. Mm. You know, it's I tell everybody when they come in that for any trauma therapy, this is going to get worse before it gets better.
Yes.
Because mm-hmm. everything yes. you've been trying to avoid through alcohol or just mm-hmm. dissociative whatever,
yes.
We're going to be walking straight into that. So yeah. nightmares are going to get worse.
Right.
Anger can get worse. Mm-hmm. Anxiety, depression can get worse, you know. And
right.
And that's good. That's information that folks need to hear, especially
Absolutely.
As we move into the next segment and talk about what treatment looks like mm-hmm. for this. So we'll talk about that as soon as we come back. We'll take a break now. You're listening to the Dr. Sonia Sutherland Show.
Eastern Standard Time on Atlanta NX on IBNXRadio.com. Join your hosts, Cherry G and Dr. Michael Shiroya, as they engage in conversation that will expose, educate, and empower you to walk into your destiny. At Destiny Talk Live, we are a judgment-free zone where we respect, appreciate, and value everyone's opinion.
When you believe,
oh, hope is real.
Do you want peace in your family relationships instead of conflict? Do you want a safe, loving marriage instead of one that is failing? Are you troubled about what's happening with your children and need help for them? At Legacy Changers Counseling Centers, the goal is to strengthen individuals and families with cutting-edge emotional and mental health interventions. The exceptionally trained counselors at Legacy provide the specialized guidance you need in a safe environment of belonging so that you can make the life changes you and your loved ones need. Get real help for your emotional and relationship needs. Call today at 404-334-7575. That's 404-334-7575. You can also find us on the web at legacychangerscounseling.com. Call now and transform your life today. 404-334-7575 or legacychangerscounseling.com.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the Dr. Sonia Sutherland Show. We're talking today about veterans and PTSD that they experience related to combat and the difficulties that they have reintegrating into civilian life because of that. So, JJ, tell us a little bit about the work that you do at Legacy Changers and the treatment and modality that you use when you're working with veterans, how it's effective, and what you've seen in terms of outcomes.
Okay. You know, within the last 10 years or so, there's been some pretty significant changes in the way we approach trauma therapy. Unfortunately, if you don't really specialize in that area, a lot of that doesn't come out. You know, the old way was just, we're gonna talk about whatever horrific experience it is till it doesn't bother you anymore.
Right. Desensitization.
Right. Mm-hmm. And that sounds horrible. I mean, even for anything, mm-hmm. you know. But there's sort of that works in what we've come to call sort of a top-down approach. But there are a lot of new therapies that are out that use more of a bottom-up approach, which is just kind of experiencing things like sensory motor therapies or somatic experiencing, something like that.
Clarifying, top-down meaning cognitive,
right?
And
right.
Bottom-up meaning
feeling.
Yes.
You know, how did what happens in your body when this mm-hmm. when this occurs. Mm-hmm. You know, there's two therapies recommended by the VA for PTSD. One of those is EMDR. That's the one I use most frequently. That stands for eye motion desensitization and reprocessing. It's not what people typically think of when they come to therapy. You know, it's based on this idea of bilateral stimulation, which just means alternating back and forth between sides of your body. And you can use tones, you can use these hand pulsers that you hold. The most frequently used method is just eye movements where you're watching this light as it goes back and forth. And what that does is it does a couple of things, really. It allows people to sort of put one foot in the past and also keep one foot in the present. As long as your eyes are following that light, your body, you know that you're in this room. Mm-hmm. So we can kind of go back emotionally while still remaining in the room. But mm-hmm. EMDR is also the only it's the only psychotherapy that physiologically changes your brain. It takes these traumatic memories from your limbic system, where there isn't a time date stamp on it, so your body's continuously re-experiencing these things. It moves them to your prefrontal cortex, so that it does put that time date stamp on it. Your body knows that this occurred then. It's not occurring now. Mm-hmm. I can calm down mm-hmm. a little bit, but that also tends to work a little better. Vets tend to not be the best about expressing emotions and talking. So, and with this type of therapy, I can work with, you know, for a lot of people, it is important to talk through that. If that's what you want to do, great. But I can work with minimal information. Mm-hmm. I just basically need to be able to create some timelines, some target clusters to see what we're going to focus on and how we're going to organize therapy. And then we just move towards the event. And we just sort of follow the natural progression that your mind follows, mm-hmm. you know. And typically, I know this is going to sound sort of crazy, but we can generally process an entire combat PTSD experience in 1 hour-long session. Mm-hmm. You know, we work off this unit of disturbance scale, and if a vet comes in and this memory is a 7, 8, 9, 10. We can generally process that down to a 0, 1, or 2 within an hour.
That's unheard of.
Absolutely.
Outside of this type of therapy.
It is yeah. tremendous. It's very effective. It's effective in a much shorter period of time. The biggest obstacle that I have is you know, emotions are, that's how we get in there. Mm-hmm. Many service members have become so good at shutting that emotion off that it takes us more time to get someone to feel so that we can get in there. But once we can do that, it's very quick. But, you know, that can take sometimes the third or fourth session we move into that. Sometimes it's 6 months later because those emotions just aren't safe.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And when you have worked with vets using EMDR, just in terms of quality of life shifts, what have you seen?
Oh, it's been tremendous. You know, one of the other things that I do is I have I'm very peculiar about psychiatric referrals. I have one psychiatrist in our area that I refer everyone to. He is terrific, and everyone has had a positive experience with him. He can really do a good job of getting whatever medications to get them regulated. He accepts TRICARE, so getting them on the right combination of medications, because it can be anything. It can be anxiety, depression. Mm-hmm. You know, it can be there's sort of psychoses that go along with these experiences also. Wow. Sometimes where in a non-flashback or non-dream state environment where you do, you catch snippets where you hear things or you may briefly see things, you know, and with some psychiatric help, we can get those things under control. It makes it a little more difficult for EMDR because in a lot of ways those negative emotions, they're numbed a little.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, I have vets that I refer, and they will come back, and I will tell them this beforehand. If he gets you to a place where you're feeling better and you don't want me anymore, that's fine. That's terrific. You're the judge of this. If you're feeling good, you know, if something changes, then you can come back. And,
right.
You know, there's been cases where medication changes have really been beneficial. Mm-hmm. You know, it just hadn't been, I'm going to throw this at you and call it done.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so you're really talking about, in terms of best practices, a combination potentially of psychiatric help and talk therapy, medication and talk therapy, and different responses from different people, depending on what types of medication they may be recommended to them, right? And I think of individuals who say, I don't want to use medication at all, right? Medication is going to make me zone out. It's going to make me a zombie. It's going to do this. It's going to do that. And unfortunately, in some cases, there are folks who over-medicate, and that is the outcome, right? Mm-hmm. And so what you say is very important in terms of finding a psychiatrist who can be trusted to really look at your individual specific presentation in such a detailed way to really try to recommend the best for you. And also, though, a part of it is educating folks to know that medication is not a panacea, right? And also, because different medications impact people differently, sometimes doctors are trying things that, this doesn't work out as well. We may need to tweak this.
Mm-hmm.
And so education says to a consumer, you know, once you have a doctor who is reported to be trustworthy, trust the process of finding the right medication for you, as opposed to having tried one that didn't work and then deciding that all medication is bad. There's that balance to be had just around psychiatric medication that can be helpful in kind of evening someone out so that talk therapy becomes a little bit more manageable and feasible to be able to do. Even in the context of it kind of numbing some of the emotion, that kind of gets in the way a little bit of EMDR.
Right.
But still, it may still allow the creation of a safe enough space for the person to even consider treatment and consider doing EMDR. And then you want also for your therapist and your psychiatrist to work together.
Mm-hmm.
If you are listening to this and you're wondering, do I need one or the other or both, what you really want is for them to be working together on your treatment and talking to each other, mm-hmm. so that, and talking to you,
right,
so that the right. three of you can collaborate on your treatment.
Right. Yeah. And, whenever everybody that comes in is different. Everybody got to my office through a different path, and everybody's going to get out through a different path, mm-hmm. But, you have to take sort of the symptom acuity into account. If things are really, if the anxiety, if the anger, if the alcoholism, whatever it is, if these things are really causing a significant problem, mm-hmm. That it's a question of safety, mm-hmm. For either the spouse or the vet themselves, mm-hmm. then certainly that's, let's try to get a hold on this through medication, bring that down a little bit. And mm-hmm. even if we use EMDR then, and we, it's not uncommon to, on that scale I talked about, to be able to bring each event down to maybe a 5 mm-hmm. or so. But because of the medication, we can't get in there under it. But, if we get to the end of that, and again, it's up to the person. What do you think about this? Do you want to try stopping the medication? And if they do, we go back mm-hmm. and we start over. Mm-hmm. We move them from a 5 down to a 0. Mm-hmm. Or they may be okay then, And it's always up to them which way they want to go, because trauma therapy is hard.
It's hard work. It's hard. And I want you to talk about how hard it is, but I also want to highlight something that you just alluded to that's just really important for folks to understand. As the client, you are in charge of your treatment.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Don't feel like, we tell our students there's no such thing as feel like. Don't believe that if you go to a psychiatrist or a therapist, that all of a sudden they are in charge of your treatment.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And you are as important a factor in determining what's best for you.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And so if you find yourself with a therapist or a psychiatrist who doesn't listen to you and who doesn't want to hear your perspective and incorporate that in making decisions about what you want to do for your treatment, that is not the therapist for you.
Right.
All right. And so that's just something I wanted to highlight because you said it.
Right.
And I wanted to make sure folks really realized that is how it's supposed to be.
Yeah, absolutely. I tell all new clients, you're my boss. I'm not the expert in mm-hmm. the room. Yeah. You hired me and you can fire me. Mm-hmm. So I need you to just be up front. And right. if something's not working, if it's not what you want to do, then we need to talk about that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then you said trauma is hard. Yeah, and sometimes we know that when we're doing trauma work with folks, it can get worse before it gets better,
mm-hmm.
right? And so we come in with an expectation, I'm going to work on my trauma, I'm going to try to do this. And at the same time, there's got to be an understanding that as you delve into it and as you really begin to, there's the potential for things to just get harder.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. I will never forget, we started EMDR with a client. It was our first session, and one of his symptoms was a lot of anger. And within, he's bald like me, and I've never seen a change come over a person this quickly. And in probably a 1 second span, his perspiration was all over his head.
Wow.
His breath hitched, and his eyes stopped moving. And as soon as I saw it, instantly I stopped and started talking to him,
mm-hmm.
calling him by name, trying to get him to talk to me.
Mm-hmm.
And he was very, very close to having a really dissociative, wow. angry experience. Mm-hmm. He was going to that place.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to really be cognizant of that. Mm-hmm. But what's terrific about that is we know we can get in there.
Yeah.
If you can feel that, then we can get in there. We mm-hmm. just have to, slow this down a mm-hmm. little bit.
Right.
And it took us, we were just sort of managing for the rest of that day. But mm-hmm. the next week he came in, we were able to move completely through that.
Wow. Yeah. That's mm-hmm. awesome.
Yeah.
And so there is hope. There is hope. And, I think the thing that encourages me as I listen to you is just remembering and hopefully helping folks hear that
you don't have to go this by yourself, mm-hmm. right? You're not the only person who experiences what you're experiencing, and you don't have to figure it out by yourself,
mm-hmm.
right? If you have a competent therapist who has a skill set similar to what JJ is talking about, you now have a partner, mm-hmm. right? And if he can refer you to a psychiatrist if needed, not automatically, mm-hmm. but just mm-hmm. if needed,
right.
right? Who can be on your team, then suddenly you're a team of three instead of one.
Right.
Right.
Right? And that's there's beautiful. Hope for being able to press through something that may be the hardest thing in your life, right? Mm-hmm. This is not why I became a counselor, but it's why I'm still a counselor, right? Mm-hmm. That's a whole nother story.
But I like how you say that, Dr. Sutherland, where it's a partnership
mm-hmm.
between you and your therapist. You have some people who are like, well, if you hear, when you think about trauma, if you hear some of the stories that I have to tell, you won't want to walk this with me.
Yeah.
But one thing I love about being a therapist and what we're trained is you just walk at the pace they're walking.
Yeah, exactly.
You don't have to run. Mm-hmm. It's just, let's slow walk this as long as you need to, mm-hmm. and we'll get through it. You know
right.
what I'm saying?
Right.
There's nothing too hard
yeah.
for us to walk through. And mm-hmm. I love the fact of adding the psychiatrist.
Yeah.
And making it a team approach,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
it makes it easier to carry a beam by three,
with three
than one.
Right.
Which makes
That's
sense.
Right. And we'll be back. We'll talk some more. We've got to take a break. It's a hard break. We'll be back with the Dr. Sonia Sutherland Show in just a minute.
Are you an entrepreneur, high-profile influencer, or creative that wants to level up in your business? If you are ready to elevate mentally, stand out visually, and dominate digitally, the Brand Doctor has the remedy. As a highly sought-after mindset coach and brand strategist, she helps clients globally to hit the ground running. Contact www.moebrandstudio.com or email getbranded@moebrandstudio.com.
Do you want peace in your family relationships instead of conflict? Do you want a safe, loving marriage instead of one that is failing? Are you troubled about what's happening with your children and need help for them? At Legacy Changers Counseling Centers, the goal is to strengthen individuals and families with cutting-edge emotional and mental health interventions. The exceptionally trained counselors at Legacy provide the specialized guidance you need in a safe environment of belonging so that you can make the life changes you and your loved ones need. Get real help for your emotional and relationship needs. Call today at 404-334-7575. That's 404-334-7575. You can also find us on the web at LegacyChangersCounseling.com. Call now and transform your life today. 404-334-7575 or LegacyChangersCounseling.com.
Hey everyone, welcome back to the Dr. Sonia Sutherland Show. We ended the last segment as we continued talking about veterans and PTSD, talking a little bit about the team approach to treatment with your therapist and maybe, if needed, your psychiatrist. And JJ, you had started talking about the types of new medications that are out there that are effective. Say
right.
a little bit more about
You know, a lot of times a component of this, one of the things that brings people in is substance use, you know, and then you find out that they're vet, and whether it's heroin or prescription opioids or alcohol, those substances really help numb things. They help calm a sort of a jangled nervous system down a little bit, you know, mm-hmm. and there's some terrific medication-assisted treatment alternatives now that are available for those disorders, so it's not just, well, you need to stop. Well, telling somebody to stop is kind of like telling somebody to calm down. It's,
right.
Why did I not think of that? You know? you know, it gives us an opportunity. If those things do exist, like the psychiatrist, I have an addictionologist that you know her that I work with a lot. She's mm-hmm. terrific. So all of a sudden, you know, you've got a four-man team, mm-hmm. you know, on your side that are working, that are collaborating mm-hmm. to try to put all these pieces together in a way that's gonna help, that's gonna be beneficial.
Yeah, yeah, awesome. And so then, you know, it takes us to wanting to talk a little bit more just about the family then,
mm-hmm.
because as you think about collaborating with professionals to help with moving you toward the functioning that you desire, right? We think about how that then impacts the family and what are the things that the family can do and what are the supports that the family will need while this is going on, right? And so before treatment, we talked a little bit about difficulty communicating, the rage or anger that sometimes is experienced that comes out in the home that the wife may see or the husband may see and the children may see, and how all of that begins to impact the family system, how the individual is not the same person that they were before they left, or how this the functioning of the family has changed because they've become a unit without that person, because they needed to be a unit without that person, right? So let's talk just a little bit about the impact of all of this on the family and things that folks need to just kind of think about and understand. You were telling a story.
I feel like just having the opportunity to experience what it's like to have the veteran come home, it was hard. It was a hard transition. You know what I'm saying? And I really feel like, yes, you're saying the VA is out there for the veterans coming in. Maybe there should be something in place for the family specifically.
How was that transition hard for you?
It was hard because my ex-husband was a submariner, so he would go out at least 6 months at a time. And he would be out 6 months, come in for a month or two, and then be out again for another 4 months or whatever. So he was only in the house 2 months out of the year. So here I am, a one-man team with the children, the house, paying the bills. And he would come in and he would disrupt everything I got going on. You know, I'm a little bit of a control freak anyway.
No, we didn't know. You? What?
So everything would be disrupted and I would be like, what is wrong with you? And I did not understand some of the pressures. Because I'm like, you're not on the front line. What's wrong with you? You're on a boat. And he was like, no, let's go down and look at it. And so the first time I had an opportunity to experience what the sub looked like, how tight the space was. I don't know if y'all remember the Widowmaker. It would happen early 1990s where the Russian submarine went down and they would not allow the Americans to go in and pull this submarine up. Well, they all died. And I remember thinking, oh my God, this is real. They've showed it on the inside, what it actually looked like. And they're in dark for 2 months before they resurface. And I was like, wow, this is interesting to see. I can't even sit in the house for 2 days. You know what I'm saying? What's it like sitting up underneath that water and you're hearing pinging? And that sometimes you can't even talk for periods at a time. So really just understanding, oh, this is what they're going through, made it a little bit easier of a transition for me not to be so rigid when he came home. You know what I'm saying? And so for the military spouse and the children, they need to be acclimated to this person coming back into their life, because now there's a little bit of a defiance. Well, you haven't been here for 2 years and now you want to come back and act like daddy or mommy. You know, so transitioning the family is very important, and really giving them some insight of what they've experienced without giving them too much information, because now you're going to traumatize, you know, the family.
So let's talk about that latter piece of it, right? Let's say that folks are able to, families are able to get a piece of understanding about what it's like to be the soldier, right? And a lot of that they won't get. A lot of that they shouldn't get, but there's got to be a way to give them something, some frame of reference. So let's say that they begin to get that frame of reference. Still, yet still, that soldier comes back and those relationships that may have been there before, or may have been there before and been good, or may have been there before and not great, and now they come back. To try to figure all of that out, right? So what does family therapy potentially look like in conjunction with whatever trauma work a soldier may be doing or a veteran may be doing? What does it look like as that family begins to figure out how do we come alongside and support this veteran as they work their way through this trauma so that they can be a part of this family in a healthy way?
Well, you know, what's really interesting is that a lot of times if we can just downregulate that nervous system, things will sometimes just slide back into, you know, into a healthy functioning. It's just when you are that hyper-aroused all the time, there tends to be a lot of snapping, a lot of yelling. What many vets have described is they come back to a family and they're ineffective. And you've got a person who is taught above all else you need to be effective. And they can't figure this out. What is going on? What's different? Why did this work before? Why does it not work now? Why am I angry now? Why are all these things going on?
And the self-loathing that comes because you can't figure that out and you can't stop.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. All of a sudden I'm failing at this. You know, and that just tends to prompt more anger, more arguments. You know, and a big piece of this is. Again, depending on the client, is at least getting the family in for some psychoeducation around what's going on, what's happening to your husband, what's happening to your wife, what's going on in their body that they can't just go back to the way things were, you know. And then, you know, if depending on acuity, we can begin family therapy then, or many times that's just kind of be too much with everything else, so we put that on hold for a little later. But we always encourage, you know, the family to, you know, if you want to bring them in one day to talk about something or just, that's always okay. You know, like I said, this is your therapy. So if you want to bring someone in, and that's fine, and we can help work through at least whatever that issue is.
Yeah. You know, I think you can't underestimate the psychoeducational piece. I think of families who... religious backgrounds or spiritual backgrounds press them toward solving this problem with prayer. And if we just pray through it hard enough, or if we just talk through it enough, we can get through it. Now, that can be true. That can be true. That path, though, is a whole lot harder.
Yes.
And longer.
Yes.
Without the psychoeducation, without the understanding of what's really going on, right? And so while there is that space and that need for that spiritual base, that's not all that there is, right?
Right.
And so I want to encourage, because I think of just my own friends and folks that I know, where counseling is really not something that they would do, but they'll pray through it, they'll fast through it, right? And they'll do all of that, and that's all great. But just understand that road is just harder, and it just takes longer.
There's still, I think, not solely for PTSD, for any mental health issue, there's still, whether we want to call it faith healing or not, there's still this idea that we can pray it away, you know, and certainly.
And it's the devil that's causing.
Yes, certainly. Certainly, God can do that. My God can heal. But I heard a preacher one time talk about, you know, the man who'd been beside the pool for 30 years, and you know, Jesus goes to him and said, "Now, Jesus stepped over somebody to get to him that was not healed." So nobody ever thinks about the people that got passed by on the way there. So, you know, God can certainly do those things. I have no idea when and where how he chooses to do that, but many times that does not happen.
Right.
You know, and I think whichever way it happens, I think certainly God wants us to use the tools that we have available to us, which is, you know, why he gave those,
That's right.
But that's the thing, you know, that community, you know, like you were talking about the team collaboration inside the counseling room and what that looks like. If you do have a faith that you are very strongly involved in, that team approach is equally as good.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying?
Add that in.
Add it, because then it supports you.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? From the outside.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Because not everybody's going to get and understand your experiences. Even the same two people at the same battle, are going to have different experiences and how they react and respond to it.
And that can be linked to their family of origin experiences. That can be linked to a lot of different things. So we talked a little bit about psychoeducation for the family, and we talked about advising them on ways that they can provide support for that veteran as they're going through their work. And if needed, as needed, conversations with family to help during that time. And then later, if needed, family therapy, maybe. And all of that really points to just a need for the non-veteran family members to really begin to create space for that veteran to struggle. And that's almost an, it's okay, I get it, type of thing. It's the difference between why can't you and it's okay. That creates such a different space for a veteran to sit in, even while they struggle with why can't I?
Right.
And so there's such a need for not just the wife and the children, extended family, parents, siblings, to really begin to understand. And it points to your original statement that there really just needs to be better education, just period, around the experiences of our veterans and the understanding of combat PTSD, just in general in our society. There's just not enough focus and understanding. There is the expectation that people go fight for us, but there's not the expectation that we have to support them on the way back in.
You know, unfortunately, you can't unring that bell. You can't go back and unhappen these things. Those memories, those things that happen will always, they're always going to be there. You know, and I think it's important for the families to realize that, to not focus on, we are not the same person. None of us are the same people. You know, it's the old saying, you can't go home again. You know, it's someone's continuously being hit over the head with, you're not the same person. Well, I know I'm not the same person. You know, a lot of things have transpired in the last 1, 2, 5, 10 years, whatever it is. You know, I have a vet on my caseload now with almost 10 deployments. You know, that's
10.
Close to 10. And, and you know, he's seen things that I'll never be able to imagine over and over and over and over again. And, does a tremendous job with all that, but it's just, you know, the pot overflows at sometimes.
Absolutely. And, you know, there's a role for churches here as well in creating safe environments and spaces and encouraging connecting with mental health providers and encouraging that connection in their parishioners, in their veterans and the parishioners in general. And I think there's got to be a way, you know, as we move into a break, and we'll come back in a minute, but there's got to be a way for us to provide that type of education for pastors and churches as well, to help bring another key piece of our society alongside in shoring up what's needed for our military. So I don't know, we need to probably talk about that offline. There's maybe a way for us to really begin to provide something in the community to do that, but I think that's a need as well. But we'll talk more when we come back.
It seems there's no way out. I know the issue seems unchangeable, and that there's no reason to shout, but the impossible is God's chance to work a miracle. A miracle. So just know it ain't over until God. Until God says it's done. No, 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 no. It ain't over. Until God says it's over. Keep fighting until your victory is won. Progress.
from 10 a.m. to noon right here on IBNX Radio for the Dr. Sonia Sutherland Show.
Listening to IBNX.
IBNXradio.com.
The station with the
best music.
Best music.
I love the music.
Best music.
Hey, what's up? It's Jay-Z.
Hey, I'm Mariah Carey.
Hey, it's Katy Perry.
It's your boy T.I.P., man. Get in.
It's your boy Sean Kingston.
What's up, y'all? I'm Beyonce.
This is Nicki Minaj, and I'm in the mix with
IBNX Radio.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back to the Dr. Sonia Sutherland Show. We have questions from the community. What do we have today?
Yes, the question from the community today is, how do you forgive? Mm. How do you let go of anger and forgive a friend that's wronged you?
We're supposed to forgive.
Listen to the white, you know, I'm just playing. Don't do that.
How do you forgive a friend that has wronged you?
Right.
Wow. Have y'all had a friend that has wronged you?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my gosh. I'm thinking about childhood now.
Yeah.
Sometimes you have children that, you know, have crossed you and betrayed you, and that brings a different level of forgiveness.
That's different. That's a different level of betrayal.
Yeah.
If you think that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's tough. Forgiveness, you know, it's definitely a process you got to go through. And, you know, looking at it, it's very similar to grief. Mm-hmm. You know, you've got to walk through that process of denial. No, they would never do this to me. They're my best friend since the second grade. Mm-hmm. How could they do this?
Yeah.
All the way through to acceptance, and sometimes you don't want to accept.
Yeah.
And sometimes it takes a long time to get there. A long time to get there.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I remember I had a childhood friend that betrayed me, fell in love with my boyfriend at the time.
The white meat. I'm just saying. Sorry. I'm a work in progress.
Ain't we all?
Oh, but
it was hard. I mean, you know, spent lots, you know, what best friends do in childhood. You do everything together.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. And it was just like, what? Get out of town. What in the world?
How old were you?
I was 16, 17, 18.
Ooh.
Yeah, so it took a long time to get to the point where I could look her in the eye and talk to her without having just these feelings running through.
Yeah.
Right? And so, I don't know. I think for me, part of what helps me forgive people, and not easily, but helps me move in that direction, is really beginning to having the desire to want to see who is this person and where is their hurt that led them to doing something like this, even though they did it to me.
Right.
It's almost like seeing them through Jesus's eyes. Where is this person's pain?
Right.
They have pain just like I have pain. If I move this situation to the side and look at everything else, and beginning to kind of understand, you know, why did that choice make sense for that person at that point in time? And that's not easy to do.
Right.
And in the two cases that I'm thinking about, it's what I've experienced is that I can do it, and then it's fine, and then something will happen and kind of ebb a little bit.
Yeah.
But then I can, you know, think about it again, and I'm trying to understand what that's like in their shoes, and it'll be fine, and do it again. And so that's what forgiveness has looked like for me. Mm-hmm. So there's never been a forget.
Right.
It's just been a choice.
Yeah.
Right.
To see something else than that situation.
I don't think you ever forget. Now, don't get me wrong. God can put a cloak over your mind in certain situations.
I've asked for that. I've never gotten it.
Well,
I'm just saying.
There's some things, you know, I'm with you. I wish he would cloak my mind quite often. But, you know, no, seriously, like, I look at it like this. The analogy that I was given was, in order to forget, it's difficult because it's like you put your hand on a stove and you touch the stove. It's hot. Right? And you burn yourself and you're like, oh, every time you go to that stove, you're like, you remember, oh my God, it burned me. Mm-hmm. So I've been, but in that, it teaches you to how to handle the stove. You no longer are going to put your hand on the stove, you know, and go ahead.
Yes. Now, let's say you keep putting your hand on the stove though.
Right.
So now we're talking about you.
Mm-hmm.
Right. What is,
what is it in you?
That right. keeps going
putting yourself back in that
to that stove
right.
and putting
right.
your hand there. Yeah. There's an unmet need that's yes. running through there
right.
that you haven't found a healthy way to meet
yeah.
yet. And
right.
so you keep going back to that stove.
So that means you need to really consider therapy
mm-hmm.
to figure out what's going on underneath
within
the
you.
Surface.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
Because
yeah.
if you keep putting yourself in that situation and you keep getting re-hurt,
mm-hmm.
and
mm-hmm.
it may not be the same person, but it may be people,
mm-hmm.
you know, that you're
mm-hmm.
doing this with.
Mm-hmm.
How do you forgive? And I think that's important. They go back.
Yeah, and then the other thing that makes me think of is when it's hardest to forgive, sometimes in that process of grief,
mm-hmm.
forgiveness being attached to a level of acceptance,
mm-hmm.
if you accept something, then that means you're releasing something.
Mm-hmm.
And
right.
if that thing that you're releasing is something that you don't want to release, meaning if I forgive this person, then I'm accepting that, it's just a scenario, I'm accepting that they will never be able to be this for me.
Yeah.
Right.
If I accept that, does that mean I will never find whatever that thing is
mm-hmm.
that I thought that person was going to give or mean to me?
Mm-hmm.
And do I really want to release that? Is that what I want to accept? That I may never find, and it could be something that is just so core to you, something that you just want, something
right.
that you desire, mm. some maybe it's a connection. And if I give that up, what does that mean for me?
Yeah.
You know, so forgiveness sometimes can be attached to that. Like, I don't want to forgive that.
Because
mm-hmm. then if I accept that, then this could be the reality, and I don't want that reality.
Mm.
So I'm going to hold on to this unforgiveness because that means I can avoid something worse.
Mm.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Fear of the unknown.
Fear, yeah.
Yeah. yeah. You know, so, sometimes you have to forgive and let go. And when I say let go, you're probably going to have to let go of that friendship.
Mm.
You know, you can forgive, but in order to be completely healed, you're going to have to let go of certain friendships. So in the same token where you're saying forgive and not wanting to accept that portion of that forgiveness, sometimes it's best to let it go,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Mm-hmm. And even if it's painful.
Right, right.
If I let that go.
Right.
You know, that person meant so much to me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
If I really let them go, will I ever have a friendship like that again?
Right.
Right.
It meant so much in my life.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And that's where you have to trust in yourself. You have to trust in the fact that you can have meaningful relationships. It was just that one relationship that took its turn,
mm-hmm.
and you can't hold all other relationships accountable for the actions of that one relationship.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So we have to be able to move forward in a sense of not holding ourselves down, so to speak, when it comes to feeling that you can't have another relationship just as strong as that,
mm-hmm.
which is not true.
Mm-hmm.
You can have a relationship stronger than that.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
you may already have one, but you're not giving
yeah.
that energy to
right.
it.
Right, exactly.
You can't recognize it
right.
because you're too busy holding on
exactly.
to unforgiveness around this one.
Right.
Yeah, I think it's like, you know, you you can't selectively repress emotion or experience. Yeah. If you suppress sadness, you suppress joy, and right. and life is about even you know, when someone passes away, even the grief and the pain in that is beautiful when you look at it from a life perspective, because right. it can only be that painful if you loved them.
You had
if, right. If you loved them that much, mm-hmm. so you know you don't want to go through life avoiding things, because it's gonna right. it's gonna restrict your experience yeah. in other ways.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
In
yes.
other ways too. Mm-hmm. You know, right. Mm-hmm. Jesus said, "Turn the other cheek." He didn't say we had to stand there and let people keep slapping us.
Yeah.
You
right.
know,
and exactly.
yeah. He also said, "Don't cast your pearls before swine. Give what's holy to the dogs." So mm-hmm. I think it's important to be able to recognize who the dogs and the swine are.
Yes, honey, because sometimes they always look alike. They'll agree over there, JJ.
Yeah.
Just saying.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so while you're holding this person and this relationship and this unforgiveness in your hand, it's taking up space.
Right.
And nothing else can come in.
Yeah.
Something
right.
better
right.
can't
so
come
that,
in.
Yes.
So, yeah, forgive and let it go.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
don't have to forget.
Yeah.
You
right.
can learn from
right.
it.
Definitely yeah. learn
understand
from it.
Better. Mm-hmm. Understand yourself mm-hmm. better.
And that's the key. Of
understand yourself
yeah.
better.
Right.
And then make space right. for something healthier.
And,
right.
and remember, it's a process.
It's all a process.
Like
yes.
you said, it took you years.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've
mm-hmm.
sat with some people who... 40 years they've held on to it.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And for me to tell them to let it go is like telling that vet, calm down. They're not going to let it go.
Well, it's such right. a huge piece of them
it
now.
Is.
Yes.
That's all they know.
That's all they know.
Yeah.
After
mm-hmm.
holding on to it for that long time. And imagine
yeah.
what they potentially have missed
right.
mm-hmm.
in relationship opportunities
right.
because of holding on to
mm-hmm.
something
yeah.
like that, whatever it is,
right.
for such
right.
a long time.
Yeah, and that's
yeah.
that's a part of who they are.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And for me to tell you to give up a piece of who you are, how can I tell you that?
You can tell them. Because
well,
they need
them.
To hear it.
Yeah.
But,
I will tell them,
you know.
But for them to listen, it's
yeah.
something different.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
You know?
All right. And so that was a good question. I hope that's helpful for the person that sent that in. So now, what do you want to talk about for the news?
So mental health in the news.
Mm-hmm.
Tomorrow mm-hmm. is voting.
Uh-oh.
Day of voting.
Uh-oh.
I hope everybody in this room has voted.
Absentee
yes.
ballots,
absentee
y'all.
Ballots.
Yes.
Absentee ballots. We all did
ballots.
Great.
Stood in line.
Yeah. For 30 minutes.
The only dumb one in the room.
Yes.
I got a sticker, though. You guys didn't get the sticker. So you got to do that.
Yeah, well, you're sporting your sticker? I don't see that sticker.
I think it's in the truck.
As long as you did it. Tomorrow is an important day for, you know, regardless of what side of the fence you're on.
Oh, wait, Matt. So, okay. So, our engineer,
oh.
David. Hi, David. David just gave me the 1 minute signal.
Oh, snap.
So,
okay. David. Did you vote? Okay, that's y'all better get out there and vote. Look.
He's laughing,
if
y'all.
You have, I'm gonna talk to him when we walk out of here.
Please, Jesus. Please vote.
Please vote. Oh my God.
Your question was
I don't know
the question anymore, but there's a lot of anxiety
okay.
around tomorrow and the voting process.
Okay.
And guys, I did look at the weather. It's going to rain tomorrow, so wear your
galoshes.
And your raincoat
hey.
And just get out there and vote,
yeah.
you know, because it does make a difference.
It's important. There's a lot at stake. It's important. We're going to take a break. We'll come back in a couple of minutes to the Dr. Sonia Sutherland Show.
The Blended Family Foundation is a national nonprofit dedicated to donating shoes, socks, and emergency clothing to students grades K through 12. BFF was started in honor of a young man named Kalen, who was tragically taken from his family at the age of 17 due to a car accident. His memory lives on through the foundation. We are seeking corporate and community partnerships to fund and support for other families in crisis. If you or your community relations team are ready to partner with us and help inspire others, please contact Tony at weblendwewin@gmail.com.
Peace in your family relationships instead of conflict? Do you want a safe, loving marriage instead of one that is failing? Are you troubled about what's happening with your children and need help for them? At Legacy Changers Counseling Centers, the goal is to strengthen individuals and families with cutting-edge emotional and mental health interventions. The exceptionally trained counselors at Legacy provide the specialized guidance you need in a safe environment of belonging so that you can make the life changes you and your loved ones need. Get real help for your emotional and relationship needs. Call today at 404-334-7575. That's 404-334-7575. You can also find us on the web at legacychangerscounseling.com. Call now and transform your life today. 404-334-7575 or legacychangerscounseling.com.
Are you an entrepreneur, high-profile influencer, or creative that wants to level up in your business? If you are ready to elevate mentally, stand out visually, and dominate digitally, the Brand Doctor has the remedy. As a highly sought-after mindset coach and brand strategist, she helps clients globally to hit the ground running. Contact www.moebrandstudio.com or email getbranded@moebrandstudio.com.
Hey everybody, welcome back to the Dr. Sonia Sutherland Show. And so we left talking about voting tomorrow.
Yes.
And encouraging everybody to vote. So I guess the question that I have is, what prevents people from actually engaging in voting? You asked me that question off the air or something close to it, and I remember knowing that for myself, when I've delayed, why do people procrastinate?
Yes.
Yeah, why do I know I have delayed in the past in voting just because I didn't like my options.
Mm.
And I was waiting for somebody to say something to make me want to vote for them.
Mm-hmm.
And so that led to the delay. And I remember one time in particular, I just didn't vote, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think, you know, hindsight says it's not the best thing to do.
Right.
You do have to weigh in, and you do have to make an effort to influence who's leading you.
Right,
right, right.
I think for, you know, looking at it from a mental health perspective, one of the reasons why I prefer getting out there is I want to know, because this is what I love to do. I believe in therapy, mental health therapy for people, not just for veterans, but for children, people, you know, who've experienced trauma.
Mm-hmm.
Getting out there and making sure that voice is heard. People need that
mm-hmm.
because there's such anxiety built around getting out there and vote. One, if you have an issue with tons of people or standing in line for a long time, that brings about a level of anxiety.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're like, oh my God, I can't go into work today because mm-hmm. I have to. There's so much stress in voting. And like you said, not knowing what the candidates stand for, because I can't
or
even.
Or knowing and not liking it.
Yeah, or knowing and not liking
mm-hmm.
it.
Mm-hmm.
What do you do with that, you know, as a person who wants to have their vote counted? And then I was watching on social media, there was tons of people posting, well, it doesn't matter, my vote is not going to count because, and I'm like.
We hear that every election.
Every
election, we get that, right? That's just like a
broken record
that just keeps coming back and bad penny coming back. And the reality is, the more people who have that mindset,
mm-hmm.
the more that will be proven true.
Right.
Right? Because they didn't vote.
Right.
And so if they wanted change, the change didn't happen because not enough people voted.
Right.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so we can't live in the prediction mode.
Right.
It won't matter if I vote. Right. Maybe what you wanted in terms of an outcome, even if you voted, didn't quite happen. That doesn't mean that you don't keep voting and you don't keep attempting. Mm-hmm. to influence the outcomes of elections.
Right.
I mean, maybe you get mad enough about that to do something else other than vote and go out and do some other stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Run for office yourself.
Absolutely. And I don't know. Again, like I was saying, I don't know what it is with election day and rain, but it's going to rain tomorrow. Like, they're talking thunderstorms. So, you know, I think people need to prepare for that and be mindful. Especially if you have someone in the elderly community, get them out there early enough so they can go ahead and cast their ballot, because their vote counts as well.
Mm-hmm. Right. And next time, get them an absentee ballot.
Absentee
so
ballot.
They don't have to go out there. Yes. And they can exercise their right from their home.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
So that's all I have on mental health. I just think it's important that mm-hmm. we vote, because there's some countries we don't have a voice.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Get out there.
And especially in the minority communities, our voice needs to be heard.
Yeah.
Our voice needs to be heard. And if we decide that we're going to abdicate our vote because it won't matter, then in essence, you're saying that you don't matter.
Right.
Right.
And that's not true.
So that's a completely different conversation.
True.
So if you don't feel like you matter, okay, where is that stemming from?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know? And there's a ton of different things on that ballot. Mm-hmm. You know, if you don't like two people, don't vote for them and move on. But, you know, there's, I can't remember, 5-6 amendments.
Amendments,
on this ballot, you know, that will affect everybody.
Everybody.
You know, so.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, when I do the absentee ballot and I see there's two people there that I don't like, I write myself in.
Wait a minute, don't be doing that, because they're going to call you to the carpet one day.
I'm going to start writing you in 2 days.
Just write myself
in.
Okay, so we all should just agree we're going to write him in
one
this time.
Yes.
Okay.
So don't look at us crazy when they call you.
I'll be right there to take the position. And you guys will be my cabinet.
Oh, Lord Jesus. In trouble now.
Is that a paying gig?
Yes.
Oh, man. All right. Well, we have just a few minutes left. I want to make sure that we wind up and just kind of summarize some of the more important things that we want to make sure folks remember. Everything that we talked about is important, obviously, but what are some key things that we want to make sure folks take away and don't forget, things that they can act on today if they're listening to this and are in this situation or know someone who's in this situation? What are some key things?
You know, I think first of all, if you know someone, I mean, everybody has a vet. Everyone has a vet in their family, at least one, if not multiple. Mm-hmm. If you know someone that's struggling with some of these things, encourage them to find someone to start working through these things with. I think people get discouraged easily and think this is just the way things are now, and I don't know what I'm going to do. And so if you can encourage them to get out and to find the therapy, treatment, whatever you want to call it, it's there. Mm-hmm. You know, we have to locate it. And if you can be supportive of those people and recognize that it's not just something that's in your mind, this is encoded in your nervous system, you know.
Right.
People don't just want to act this way. They're not doing these things on purpose, you know. So just an education piece, you know. We have the blessing of the internet today, and there are some terrific resources out there that can teach you all about combat PTSD and a lot of things a vet's experience. Get involved. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a lot of statistics on how often a vet commits suicide or how many homeless vets there are in the United States. Become vocal about those things in your community, to your legislators. Mm-hmm. What do we have to start doing to change some of these things?
Absolutely. Get out and vote for the folks that believe what you believe about vets.
Right, right.
Yeah. So you pointed to getting help, encouraging your vet and your family to find therapeutic help. Mm-hmm. And added to that, find a therapeutic team.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Support groups.
Consider, educate yourself around psychiatric help in terms of medication.
A big key. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right? You know, don't just rely on what you think you know. Find out more. There is always something that you don't know that will be helpful.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'd say be patient. Not just with the vet, you know, if you are the spouse of a vet or the child of a vet who is coming home with PTSD, be patient with them, because there is a transition that they have to make coming back to the United States, transitioning back into the family. And then be patient with yourself, for real, because you're going to want to get frustrated with them. How come dad is sitting at home and not coming to the ball game, or how come mom is, you know, doing this and it's prom season? You know, start having those conversations. Like you said, educate yourself, not just on the different types of treatment that they have, but also what experiences are they having that I may not be able to experience with them, but at least I'm a little bit more knowledgeable mm-hmm. of what that looks like. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm.
And I would say to that vet, don't isolate yourself.
Yeah, don't do that.
Yes. You know, that is a common approach to dealing with what they're experiencing, just isolating yeah. and getting off by themselves and wanting to be away from people and mm-hmm. and that is just dangerous. It doesn't move you in the direction that you really are wanting to go in, mm-hmm. right? It just moves mm-hmm. you deeper into the hole
right.
that you're already in. Yeah. And so don't isolate. Reach out for that help as well. And pay attention. For those high-functioning mm-hmm. vets, pay attention when someone says, what's going on with you? Something isn't right. Don't kind of blow it off and say, mm-hmm. you know, don't believe everything everybody tells you, but certainly investigate. Choose self-awareness. Choose to be very aware about how you're functioning. And don't be afraid of looking at yourself in the mirror and saying, okay, maybe there's something here I need to address. Mm-hmm. And then going to get that help to address it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And remember, too, that there is no... There should be no blame that you place on yourself because you've had the experiences that you've had.
Yeah.
Right.
Right. I think a lot of our vets have been placed in situations where they've just had to function.
Mm-hmm.
And so their experiences may not have been of their own making. Right. And then here they are right now. And so I guess my encouragement is, you know, find support that lets you know and continues to help you understand that you're not alone. You didn't do this to yourself. Help is out there. Just find it in the right place. Mm-hmm. Find it in the right place. JJ, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you.
Thank you for the work you do at Legacy Changers with the vets that you work with and others that you work with. And we hope that you'll be back on the show and talking about some other stuff as well. And we'll definitely be referring folks to you as they come.
Thank you.
To work in that area. Y'all, thank you for joining the Dr. Sonia Sutherland Show today. I hope this information has been helpful to you. Please feel free to reach out to us at www.helpformyfamily.com if you have questions or want some additional resources. And we will post this on the IBNX site. As well as on the Legacy Changers site as well. Have a great day, you guys. What's coming up next is the Leadership Blend with Ricardo Rice at noon, so stay tuned. Don't go anywhere. Hang out with Ricardo.
Thanks for listening to the Dr. Sonia Sutherland Show. If you have any questions about the broadcast, please feel free to reach out to Dr. Sonia at www.helpformyfamily.com. That's www.helpformyfamily.com. And be sure to join us every week at this same time for the Dr. Sonia Sutherland Show, right here on IBNX Radio.
IBNX Radio.